Imaginos, a bedtime story for the children of the damned. From a dream world paralleling our Earth in time and space, the Invisible Ones have sent an agent who will dream the dream of history. With limitless power, he becomes the greatest actor of the 19th century. Taking on many disguises, he places himself at pivotal junctures in history, continually altering its course and testing our ability to respond to the challenge of evil. His name is Imaginos.
When I was 5 years old, I lived in Greece for a year. My dad worked for something called Voice of America. It was basically a propaganda thing that broadcast jazz and American comedy and stuff into Russia to show the Russians how great the people in the United States had it. We lived for a week or so, or maybe 2 weeks, a little while, in Athens. And that was the first time I was ever in a tall building. And we had a balcony, and I could go out, look out over the street and see. And it was, of course, the first big city I'd ever been in, well, other than Boston. And then we drove to a long ways, it seemed like, to a place that they called Salonika. So we lived there for a year, you know, and it was quite an experience. I remember we drove to Turkey one day. We just hopped in the car and went to Turkey and then drove back for dinner. My parents tell me that I spoke Greek. I don't remember that. When I got back, there was only one word that I could remember, but it was an important word. It was gala. But I had all these Greek friends, you know. I had the kids in the neighborhood. I had a birthday there, and I got all these toys, right? And I started giving the toys away to my Greek friends because they didn't have any toys. And of course, my parents were furious. They're like, you don't know the value of things. I said, yes, I do. It makes my friends happy. So that's valuable to me too. You know, not just having it. You know, I'd played with them for a while. And, you know, as long as I got to play with them for a couple of weeks, you know, I didn't mind giving them away. I mean, I have a deep affection for Greece, really. I mean, not just because I live there, but because, you know, we owe so many things to the ancient Greeks, you know. Pythagoras, you know, somebody asked me if I could have dinner with anybody, and I said Christ, and then I said, no, you know what, I think I'd rather have dinner with Pythagoras. That would be amazing. But it had to be vegetarian, because he was a vegetarian, I heard. Yeah. And no beans. Well, there were several factors. One of the big ones was that I would be getting emails from fans saying, you know, this is, you know, I heard your demos and, you know, they're really great. When are you going to like actually release it? Can you talk the record company into releasing it as an official release? Because really those demos were just rough mixes of the album that I had on cassettes. They weren't even really, you know, they were very crude and basic. 4 years ago, when they put out the 40th anniversary box set, I asked the manager if he could ask the record company to, you know, remix my version of the album. I got this reply from the record company that that record was the worst selling Blue Oyster Cult record of all time. Worse than Club Ninja, worse than the first Blue Oyster Cult record. It was just, you know, and so they didn't see any point in doing that. And what I didn't know is that they actually didn't even have the tapes to do it. So it was actually impossible. Sandy Perlman had taken all the tapes. Last year in September, I have once a month, I do a radio show on my son's internet radio station. It's WFKU.org. And so we started doing live broadcasts. Instead of playing records, I was playing live and with myself and my bass player, David Hirschberg. Whenever we'd play an Imaginos song, people would go crazy because these songs were not ever played live except for one song, I think, one or maybe two songs. I think just one. I Am the One You Warned Me Of. That's, I've seen that played live, you know, tapes of them, you know, back when they did the Greek tour. I decided, well, we should learn them all. We'll learn all the Imagino songs. And so, and by that time, it was more than just me and David Hirschberg. So I started making demos for the band to, you know, and I put them up on, you know, in Dropbox, and they could download them and put them on their phone or whatever, and listen to them and practice. Around the middle of February, I said, let's record these. Let's go into a studio and record them, and then we'll put out our own Maginos record. Of course, and I didn't think that it was going to be completed anytime soon, because I have another group with my brother called Blue Coop. We were going to go on tour in Europe in May. So I thought, well, we'll work on this Imagino stuff until we can go there. And of course, by the end of February, the tour was canceled. And I couldn't even have my band come to the house because of the quarantine. So I just started recording all the songs myself. I replaced the demo drums with my own drums, and I played rhythm guitars, and I got all the songs together to some degree. When they started opening up again, I had the bass player, David Hirschberg, come over, and he played bass on all the songs and sang background vocals on all the songs. And before the quarantine, Mookie Thomas had played keyboards on one song and sang background vocals on four songs. Then it was a matter of sending off the basic tracks to people to add their parts. So I had my brother Joe played trumpet on a couple songs. I have a Southern rock fiddle player playing violin on a couple songs. I have RJ Ronquillo, who is a sensational internet, you know, star, guitar. He played a lead electric lead guitar on four songs. I played electric lead on four songs. Ross, the boss from the Dictators, played electric lead on one song. Jack Rigg, who was on the original Maginos, he played lead on one song. And a fan of mine who had been talking to me about recording a version of Girl That Love Made Blind, he played guitar on one song. So, and also my son Ace plays keyboards on three songs. So, and I play the keyboards on the rest.
The Oyster Boys are swimming now. One deal is one pay. Forest keys and whirlwind cold. Green keys, blue and keys, gold. Keeping locks that won't explode.
As a matter of fact, the whole arrangement that the new arrangement that I have of it is exactly how Sandy wanted it to be originally. He told me how he wanted the intro to go, and, you know, with the hand claps and the harmonies and all of that, that's how he wanted it to be. You want to know why I'm doing this? It's really, for me, it's because I want to pay tribute to the genius of Sandy Pearlman. I mean, he really was a genius. And if you listen to this, especially the way that I lay it out, he wanted it to be like a nursery rhyme or a fairy tale or some sort of campfire song, you know, something, you know. And that was how it was introduced to me, as a story before there was any lyrics, you know, as a story sitting around a bunch of candles, you know, with a bunch of stoned hippies, you know, in 1967. That's when I heard the story. But he didn't have lyrics, so they would come, you know, bit by bit. You know, I think the last song he gave me was Les Invisibles. So, you know, but it was all supposed to be part of this thing. Even something like Workshop of the Telescopes or Odeed on Life, they all have elements of Imaginos.
Chatter on the tide of the lost and language lost. Hear them chatter on the tide. We understand, we understand, we understand. And so do I. We understand, we understand. But fright is real.
Yes. When when I was doing it and people were saying, are you going to do the trilogy? I was like, well, I don't know. We'll see. We'll see. If people respond to this, if it's worthwhile, because it's going to cost money, you know, to do all this and doing what I'm doing right now, the publicity is also costing me money. So, but, you know, I'm happy to do it. You know, it's the first opportunity I've had to do this kind of thing. And since I've been in Blue Oyster Cult, which is over 30 years ago. So I plan to have everybody, all of them, you know, look at it this way. I played on their record. I didn't ask for any money. I didn't even ask for credit, you know, but so I think that they owe me. This time they actually owe me. The next volume will have my own versions, or, you know, versions with BOC, but new versions of songs that were already recorded, you know. So I could make the whole second volume just with stuff that's already been recorded, but I also have three songs that Sandy had written for that I will record also. When they did the Greek tour in 1988. That was a heartbreaker for me because I lived in Greece for a while. Blue Oyster Cult was going to do their first Greek tour. And Imaginos had just come out as a Blue Oyster Cult record. So I called them up and said, listen, I need to know what flight we're going to be taking because I have to expedite my passport. I'm not ready. You know, my passport is expired. So they said, oh, you're not going. Didn't you know you're not going? We got another drummer. I'm like, what? But you just put out my record. They said, well, you're welcome. They said, we did you a favor, you know. You're not doing us a favor, you know. We're doing you a favor. Sandy talked us into it. And I said, well, I thought, you don't know the chords. You don't know the songs. I can teach them to you. And they're like, nah, we're just going to do this tour. It's already not selling very well, so. You know, so that was the sad fact of that issue. And that's why that was one of the reasons why I was upset with them doing it, was because I was under the impression that I was going to be back in the band, at least to promote the record. So, you know, because I'd still, you know, even though they overdubbed their voices on the record, I was still singing, you know, some of the songs. So. I gotta be honest. I cried. I was so disappointed. I was disappointed in everything. It was, first of all, when we started, Sandy and I were like, we're going to be co-producers. You're going to be the, and now he's demoted me to associate producer. What the hell is that? We both had the same amount of skin in the game, you know, as we say here. He worked hard. I worked hard. You know, it seemed like it should be an equal partnership, but he somehow, I don't know, he decided he had to save the record by convincing Blue Oyster Cult to do it. So the deal had changed. So, but, you know, and I was mad at Sandy. I hated how they kind of made it seem like the original band didn't do that much, that it was all Blue Oyster Cult. You know, I asked Donald, I said, did you play any guitar on this at all besides the Gil Blanco County that they left off? Because he does play lead guitar in Gil Blanco County on my version, you know, of course, but because Gil Blanco is not on their version. So, but he said, yeah, I played on every song and they didn't use any of it. He was mad. He's like, you know, but they were into what was already there, you know, and there was plenty of really good guitar players. You know, you had Mark Biederman, you had Robbie Krieger, Aldo Nova, Joe Satriani. You know, there was lots of, you know, Phil Grandy. I don't know, you probably never heard of him, but he was a local New York hotshot. So there was plenty of guitar. They really didn't need any more. You know, it was already a wall of sound by the time they got it. You feel me in the urban breeze. I'll be there. I love it. I love it. I mean, I can't say I love every song, but there is four or five just really strong songs, better than anything they've done since I've been in the band. You know, I was actually listening to Firebone and Origin this morning. I have a radio show tonight that I'm doing, but I'm not going to play live. I'm just going to spin records. And basically what I want to do is compare and contrast their new album with some of their old records. When I heard Florida Man, I thought, oh, that sounds like Harvest Moon. And so then I listened to Harvest Moon. I'm like, oh yeah, it is a lot like Harvest Moon. Florida Man, Harvest Moon, you know, it's the same melody, you know. The recorded output did diminish a bit, you know, after I wasn't there. I was the guy that I would obsess about these songs. And I mean, that's one of the reasons why my name is on so many of them, because people would write something and there would be a problem and I would fix it. I would always fix it. Sometimes it was just a matter of changing somebody's part or changing something that I was doing. But a lot of times it was like, you know, the music needed to be rewritten in a different way to make it actually work better. So they didn't really have anybody who was doing that. You know, I was the one that did it. And when they got Rick Downey was a fine drummer, but he didn't know anything about making records or writing songs. So it was a deficit for them, you know. And, you know, maybe if we hadn't gone our separate ways with as much acrimony as it was, they might have asked me to help them, which I would have gladly done. But they wanted to see how they could do without me, I think. So, and they saw. But now they have Richie Castellano, who's just like me. I mean, he is. I mean, you know, he is a guy that never stops. He just, like, whatever it is, there's a problem, he fixes it. So they've got their new Albert Bouchard, and his name is Richie Castellano, and he'll be around a lot longer than I will, probably. Sandy wrote the lyrics in 72, you know, right in the very early days, but they didn't, Joe... You know, nobody had an idea that we had so many other songs on the fire to work on. So it's kind of sat there for a while. And then we had a band house in Eaton's Neck. And, you know, Joe was walking on the beach and he got this idea for the opening melody. You know, the clock's like 12 and noon, you know, it's never said at all. And map the read, you know, all of that. He wrote that. And then he played it for the band and Sandy was a little upset because Joe had left off half the lyrics. You know, it was, you know, it's a lot of words in that song. So Joe had just taken, he took the part that that resonated with him, and he left out the rest of the stuff. Then a year goes by, and I'm in a house that belonged to Eric Bloom that became that he had rented, and it was becoming the band house. It was where we would practice in the basement. And I split up with my wife, and I didn't have a place to stay. So Eric said, listen, I got this house. You can stay in the band room. So I said, oh, okay, thanks. You know? And so I was in the band room. Nobody was there. Eric was off, you know, with his, on his date with his person that became his wife. But anyway, he was off with her. And so I was all by myself in the house. You know, he was not coming back that night. So I was in the house, and I had started going out with this girl from Chicago. And I was thinking about her, and I was fooling around on the piano, and I played this little... And I'm like, oh, that sounds like her. Hey, I wonder if this would work in Joe's song, you know? And I I said, well, you know, I sang it. And then I get to that other part, you know, where, you know, between the second and the third verse, and I start playing that riff and I'm like, oh, this is good. And then I'm like, wait, maybe I can take these changes that I put in here for this, you know, which went boom, 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 boom. I mean, it's, you know, at the time I thought it was brilliant, but you know, it's pretty ordinary now because everybody is using those changes. But so then I took the other words that he hadn't used and I wrote the middle section, you know, four doors at the Four Winds Bar, which everybody gets that wrong. I don't want to go into it, but you know, Eric sang it wrong on the original recording. And of course, Sandy was like, no, you got to sing four doors at the Four Winds Bar. So Eric started singing it like that live, but it was Four Winds on the original recording. And when Metallica recorded it, James sings Four Winds instead of Four Doors. And then when I did my version and Joe heard it, he's like, you know, you're singing the wrong lyrics. I said, no, I'm singing the right lyrics. That's what Sandy wants.